Good evening and welcome to Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. An attorney supporting Senate President Russell Pearce filed a lawsuit yesterday to challenge signatures and petitions submitted by groups working to recall Pearce. The suit claims the petitions do not comply with statutory and constitutional requirements. Here to talk about the challenge is Arizona Secretary of State Ken Bennett. Good to see you here. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, Ted. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. I'm trying to figure out this suit now. I'm seeing about eight major claims in here.
Correct. Uh-huh.
What are you seeing?
There are eight separate claims. The first two involve the wording on the backs of the petition where the circulator has to swear to certain things that they've done. They witnessed the person signing in their presence, and it was done on the date that they said it was, and they believe the address to be correct. The question on the first one that intends to throw out all of the signatures is that in the Constitution, it says that this statement that the circulators have to sign on the backs of each petition needs to say, quote, that the signatures are genuine. Well, when the legislature wrote the laws to kind of fill in the details and tell our office what's supposed to be on the back of the petitions, they use words like, you know, they signed in my presence, they signed on the date indicated, they live in the district, or they're a qualified elector, or I believe their address and other information to be correct. And so their argument is that because they didn't use the exact word are genuine, and instead used in all these other descriptors, that somehow doesn't meet the constitutional requirement of using the word are genuine.
So the word genuine is in the Constitution, but the statute says if you do X, Y, and Z, that's genuine.
Well, you kind of infer from the statute, which the legislature passed, I guess that was their way of expressing genuineness, that
yes.
if the person really signed in front of me and they signed on the date that they were supposed to, and they live where they're supposed to, and they live in that district and all that. I guess that was the legislature's way of filling in the gaps of what's genuine or not. But because the lawsuit argues that because they didn't use the word genuine on the back of the sheet and use those other things, that doesn't meet the Constitution.
The lawsuit also mentions that the signer must print their own address, and a petition would be invalid if the circulator put that address in there.
Well, they're arguing two things, and one of them is correct, and that is that on initiative and referendum petitions and on recall petitions, there is an extra requirement in state law that the person who signs their name and prints their name has to also be the person that actually writes their address, mm-hmm. as opposed to having the address filled in by the person who was collecting the signatures. One of the arguments that I think has maybe quite a bit of merit is that the person who signed their name also has to print in their address information and the date. That's one of their eight arguments.
Okay.
But they're also arguing that if one of the people did that incorrectly, that they should also throw out all the rest of the signatures that might have been done correctly, and that seems a little bit of a stretch.
I was going to ask about that. They're saying every single signature is tossed if they find one with a problem. Where does that come from?
Well, that is coming from an argument that they're trying to say that on the back, when the circulator signed their sworn statement, that all of these people do live where they say they lived, and they signed it in front of me and on the right date and
yes.
everything, that if one of those happens to be wrong on the front of the petition, then because I signed a statement saying that I thought all of them were correct, one of them was bad,
it's all bad. Okay.
Which we don't apply that standard in any other petition signature gathering type process in the state, but they're alleging that argument in this case.
There's also an allegation that the reasons for the recall were confusing to voters.
Mm-hmm.
You've got the petition there. I mean, it from a distance, I see Russell Pearce's name, I see recall. I don't see a heck of a lot of confusion. What are they saying here?
Well, they're saying that the group that is recalling somebody gets to put up to 200 words on the petition, kind of saying why they are recalling someone. And the lawsuit alleges that the last statement doesn't clearly indicate some problem that they have or reason why they're recalling Mr. Pearce, or wanting to recall Mr. Pearce. It just says that by signing this petition, we publicly withdraw our support for Russell Pearce and what he represents. And so they're saying that sentence kind of alone is unclear or somehow leaves the signers of the petition with an unclear idea that they were really calling for a recall election.
But isn't this titled the recall?
Yeah, it's called a recall petition.
Yeah.
And it says at the beginning of that 200-word sentence, submit this, we the undersigned or whatever, submit this petition to recall State Senator Russell Pearce. So there's other sentences in those 200 words that clearly seem to indicate that it's a recall petition on Mr. Pearce, but the last sentence just talks about withdrawing their support from him, and they claim that that creates confusion.
Did you help vet the language on these petitions?
No, and I want to be clear that as the chief elections official and our office, we don't, when somebody brings in a proposed recall petition, we don't say, well, you ought to word it this way or you ought to mm-hmm. word it that way. It's not our job, other than to say you get no more than 200 words and you should express why you are doing the recall. But once they put their reasons down, we don't really have the role of second guessing that. But now this group that has filed the suit yesterday is trying to convince a judge that this 200-word statement that was on the front of each petition did not clearly indicate that this was a recall, that this might end up being a recall election.
If a judge, and most folks who are looking at this thinks it would be unlikely, but if a judge were to say, all right, I do have problems with this, we go from where? Here, appeal to the Supreme Court, State Supreme Court, you have a certain amount of time to do this. We do have an election coming up here in November.
Yes, we have some very short time frames. Depending on what a judge says at the Superior Court level, which is where this was filed yesterday, depending on what type of a decision comes from the judge at the Superior Court, the losing side could obviously then immediately appeal it to the state Supreme Court, ask for expedited hearing, because we've got some things that are pretty important to the election that need to start happening in early August, such as filing.
Sure.
Other candidates need to start filing signatures. Mr. Pearce gets on automatically, but anyone else who might want to run against him has to start collecting and filing signatures, or $5 qualifications to run into the clean election system. So a lot of stuff needs to start happening in a few weeks.
All right, very good. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate
it. My pleasure. Thanks.